Good evening and welcome to our Good Friday service. I'm glad you've chosen to join us tonight. I'd like to begin with a reading from the book of Hebrews, chapter 13. We have an altar from which those who serve the tent have no right to eat. For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the holy place by the high priest as a sacrifice for sins are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. As we begin tonight, let's focus on the sacrifice of Christ and his shed blood as we sing together this familiar hymn, Nothing But the Blood of Jesus. For this evening, where we can pause to remember your great love for us and the sacrifice that you made on Calvary. We thank you that through the blood of Jesus Christ, our sins can be forgiven and that we can be welcomed into the presence of a holy God. We ask that tonight you would give us a clearer vision of all that you endured on that night and all that you have prepared for those who love you. Bless us as we worship you, we pray for Christ's sake. Amen. Tonight's Good Friday service is called the Seven Voices of the Cross. And in the context of this service, over the course of the next few moments together, you'll be hearing people reading a script, a narrative of those who were a part of the passion story of Jesus Christ. I hope you'll listen carefully to these stories, and you'll also have the opportunity to view some beautiful artwork that represents the events of that last few days of Christ's life, and the opportunity to sing more hymns, more songs about the sacrifice of Christ. These seven voices of the cross give us the opportunity to go back to those events that are essential to our faith. And as the hymn writer said so many years ago, lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let's worship him now together as we hear these stories.
The voice of Caiaphas is the voice of prophecy. This man, born in the priestly family of Levi, was a direct descendant of Aaron. He had dedicated his life to a diligent study of Scripture, and if anyone knew what to look for in the promised Messiah, it was Caiaphas. Others might overlook Messiah's appearance when he arrives, but not him. When Messiah arrived, Caiaphas would be right at his side, leading a glorious parade to crown him the victorious king of Israel. As the years passed, he worked his way up the ladder of the professional clergy, eventually occupying the highest position possible, the high priest of Israel. And as he accrued power, his former love for the Torah was replaced by a dedication to preserving his place and prestige. He had seen many short-term messiahs come and go, and when he heard of the present rabbi from Galilee, he knew immediately that Jesus was a fraud. Messiah would be born of David's family, and this Jesus, well, no one was really sure who his father was. But unlike other messiahs, Jesus' popularity with the people was nearly overwhelming. He seemed to be able to leverage demonic power to do tricks and mesmerize the people. He drew the attention of the Roman authorities as well, and this threatened to upset the settled order of things. It quickly became evident that something must be done to silence the voice of this false teacher. A group of Pharisees came knocking on Caiaphas's door late one night, having just witnessed another trick by the deceiver. Jesus and a fellow conspirator named Lazarus had staged a fake miracle and had fooled everyone into believing that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. There had previously been unsuccessful attempts to trick Jesus on some technical question about the law or catch him violating it. More recently, there had been backroom conversations among them to find a way to abduct Jesus secretly. Though some among them had expressed reservations about such actions, even they must now be made to see that the problem of Jesus had to be resolved one way or another.
Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper spots and melt the heart of stone. 'Cause Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Throne, I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. 'Cause Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
voice of Judas is the voice of betrayal. Judas was a man of high hopes, high expectations, and high aspirations. And while others followed Jesus to see the next show or the next free meal, he was one of the first to see Jesus' true potential. There was an odd power, an authority in Jesus' voice that Judas knew he could leverage to his advantage. But his disappointment with Jesus started early. Jesus spent too much time with children and women. What could they possibly do to advance the cause? And he often wondered why Jesus continued to confront the Pharisees when joining forces with them just might make an impact on the Roman oppressors. The final straw was Jesus' complete misunderstanding of the value of money. He once talked of a single lost coin as if it mattered. He noticed an old woman putting 2 pennies in the offering box, as if that could make any difference. And then, when the valuable perfume was poured so lavishly, what a waste. Well, if Jesus refused to have a meaningful conversation with the Pharisees, he would. And maybe he could put a little money in his pocket at the same time.
The voice of Peter is the voice of denial. The first words he had spoken to Jesus 3 years earlier now thundered in his mind, and he could not escape them. On that day, it was a sudden, miraculous catch of fish that sent Peter to his knees, crying, "Lord, go away from me, for I am a man full of sin." And now here in the darkness, after this unthinkable act of betrayal, the full impact of those words have tracked him down and exposed his weakness and infidelity. Since those early days, there had been many bold actions along the way. Peter once jumped out of a boat and walked on the surface of the water with Jesus. Just a few hours ago, when Jesus was arrested in the garden, Peter lunged at the head of the servant of the high priest with a knife and nearly killed him. And Peter's bold actions were accompanied by bold words. When others hesitated, he boldly declared, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And just last night, he bravely promised, "Even if everyone else deserts you, I never will." Peter found a place of darkness where he could hide. As he wept for sorrow, David's ancient words burned in his heart. "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment."
Thank you. The voice of Pilate is the voice of indecision. Pilate was a cautious man, a fearful man, a hesitant man. Pilate was a man of weakness, strategically placed in a position of authority so that he could be easily manipulated by those around him. Pilate was not a man who could think for himself. He always had a finger to the wind to discern the breezes of power and popular opinion. He found it far safer to ask questions than to make statements. The Gospels record abundant questions designed to delay and defer, but precious few statements of personal values or conclusions. His endless questions were neither inquisitive, argumentative, or persuasive. He was not about to expose himself by taking a position on a subject. No, his questions were always only self-serving, designed to dodge responsibility or pass the blame to others. But now standing before him is the Word who was in the beginning with God. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus spoke as one who had authority and not like the Jewish leaders of the time. Jesus refused to answer Pilate's questions. Unnerved by Jesus' silence, the fountainhead of questions erupts. Are you the king of the Jews? Have you no answer to make? Do you see how many charges they bring against you? Don't you know I have the power to release you or to crucify you? Then, in desperation, Pilate turned his questions to the religious rulers. What accusation do you bring against this man? Why should I crucify him? What evil has he done? Finally, seeking to dodge the matter entirely, he spoke to the people outside. Which of these two do you want me to release? Barabbas or the king of the Jews? Why? What evil has he done? Unknowingly, Pilate asks the question that must be answered by all of Adam's children. What shall I do with Jesus, the one who is called the King of the Jews? Pilate believed that by ceremonially washing his hands, he might be absolved of the question. But he was wrong. It is a universal question that must be asked and answered by everyone who has ever lived. To refuse to answer the question is itself a decision to reject Christ. What shall I do with the one who is called the King of the Jews?
I invite you to join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, as we read the words and hear the questioning voice of Pontius Pilate, as he encountered our Savior Jesus Christ face to face, we are amazed and we are humbled. We are amazed because we see Jesus, the greatest King of all, not just the King of the Jews, but the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, standing before a powerful worldly ruler, but doing so with the deepest of humilities, while being perfectly innocent of any of accusation that was brought against him, so much so that Pilate could find no fault with him. Jesus makes no effort to justify himself. As Isaiah 53 predicted, Jesus was like a lamb led to the slaughter. He was like a sheep that was silent before his shearers, and he opened not his mouth to defend himself. And yet when he did open his mouth, when he did speak, Jesus stated with perfect conviction, based in perfect truth, that his kingdom was not of this world. He had come, in fact, into this world for the purpose of bearing witness to the truth, and he invites us to listen to his voice and to trust him. Yet, Father, we often choose to listen to other voices, voices other than that of our Savior, we confess. Like the Jews, we too reject our Savior and King, preferring to love and serve other kings that this world offers us. We reject our King and instead serve our old master sin, whose wages are death and pain. And for this reason, the questioning voice of Pilate also humbles us. Pilate's question is one that we are faced with every day. Then what shall I do with this Jesus who is called the Christ? Pilate offered the crowds their king, and yet they eagerly cried and called out for his crucifixion, desiring instead a criminal named Barabbas. How often, Father, are we like them, turning our backs on our king, preferring instead to pursue false kings who rule over worldly kingdoms, leading to death? We know, Father, that your desire is for us to recognize that our Savior lived his life and died his death so that we might experience the grace and the forgiveness and the newness of life that he offers us each and every day. Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Christ? Father, when we encounter Pilate's question, our prayer is that we will turn to Jesus Christ, the one who is called the Christ, in a deepening trust and obedience. May we answer this question with faithfulness each day, for the one in whom we hope is faithful and true. In the name of Jesus, who is called the Christ, we pray, and through the power of your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Years ago, we agreed that we would see this thing through together. Simon, Barabbas, and I had grown up together in Galilee, and all our lives we had witnessed the cruelty of the Romans. It was repulsive to us to see how many people decided to just go along with the oppressors, speaking their language, wearing their clothes, even taking on Gentile names. We grew up hearing stories of patriots like Judas Maccabeus who resisted the Romans, and we felt called to take up the sword to honor their memory. We were few in number and had to work in secret. Even if we couldn't drive out the entire Roman army, we could make individual Romans wish they had never set foot on our holy soil. We assumed vocations like the others to blend in, but secretly the three of us joined the Sicarii, the dagger bearers. A Roman official who moved through a large crowd unguarded was taking his life in his hands if one of us was around. Some time ago, I heard about a fellow revolutionary, a Galilean, who was gaining notoriety and attracting large crowds. I followed him one day to see if he could be recruited for our cause. He spoke with amazing authority, but not like the other rabbi, and certainly not like our leaders. At first, his words seemed foolish. "Love your enemies," he said. "Pray for those who despitefully use you." I heard him tell his followers that if a Roman soldier constrained them to carry a burden for 1 mile, they should willingly volunteer to carry the load for a second mile. I would have dismissed him and his teachings out of hand had it not been for, well, his obvious love for our people. He gave the people hope, even in a time of foreign occupation. He touched people who were horribly diseased. They were clearly bound to die, but somehow he healed them. I was there in the city of Nain when he happened upon a funeral procession. He wept for sorrow over a young boy that he had never met, but then he went over to the coffin and brought the boy back to life. Yes, I saw it happen myself. And the joy that overwhelmed that boy's mother, well, I've never seen anything like it. I should have known it was only a matter of time. You can't live on the edge forever. The three of us were in the market last week when Barabbas saw what we call a target, a Roman soldier separated from his detachment. Simon created a distraction. I watched for other soldiers, and Barabbas carried out the act. We made our escape during the chaos that ensued, but ran directly into the path of a squad of soldiers. There was nowhere to hide. Barabbas was severely beaten. Simon suffered a horrible wound from a Roman spear, and we were all thrown into prison. Early this morning, we could hear what sounded like a riot forming nearby. A great crowd had gathered, and from our cell we could make out some of what they were shouting. "Crucify him! Crucify him, they yelled. But who were they talking about? They yelled even louder. His blood be on us and on our children. Clearly, the mob had been driven to a frenzy and were demanding the death of some poor person. Then our blood ran cold as we heard them yell, "We want Barabbas! We want Barabbas!" A brief pause, and then they yelled even louder, "Let him be crucified!" I've never seen such horror as what I saw on the face of my friend in that moment. The noise of the crowd subsided, and we could hardly breathe. Soon, in the distance, we heard the footsteps of soldiers, a Roman detachment approaching our cell. Simon began shaking, and Barabbas was pale with fright. A centurion unlocked the door and spoke in a commanding voice, "Barabbas, get out of here. You've been set free." Frozen in shock, none of us could move. Barabbas's senses returned and he bolted for the door. The other soldiers moved into the cell as the centurion yelled, "You two, get up. It's time for you to die." They bound us and dragged us outside the city to that hill that looks like a skull, Golgotha. One cross had already been erected, the one that should have been Barabbas's. As I looked, I could not believe my eyes. How could it be? Jesus, the teacher that I had met years before, he was the man hanging on Barabbas's cross. A sentence of death amplifies a man's natural traits. Simon and I had lived violent lives, and that day we wreaked violence and cursing on the soldiers and everyone nearby. But what I saw in Jesus was exactly what I had heard from him many months before. Even in the throes of his own agony, he spoke of love. He committed the care of his mother to one of his followers. He called God his Father and asked God to forgive those who were killing him. The soldiers nailed us each to a cross and lifted us up into place, Simon on one side of Jesus and me on the other. Suddenly, I could see the scene from Jesus' perspective. I listened as Simon turned his curses and taunts on Jesus, and in the distance beyond him, I'm almost sure I saw Barabbas watching from the edge of the crowd. I knew I had wasted my life and would soon face God's judgment for what I had done. "Simon," I cried out, "we are being punished here justly for the things we have done, but this man is innocent." And then to Jesus, I said, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." In the final moments of his life, he shared with me the love he had shown to so many others. I saw hope, maybe even joy in his eyes, as he said to me, "Today you will be with me in heaven."
Thank you.
is crushed to death. Life is mine to live, won through your selfless love. Is the power
I've had enough. Enough of this war, enough of the travel, enough of the hardship. I've had enough of the killing. I just can't do this anymore. I'm a Roman centurion. I command the lives of 100 men, but right now I just want to gather my family and get back home to Corinth. This is not what I signed on for when I joined the Roman Legion. We aren't at war with any nations. There are no new lands to conquer or people to subdue. We were sent here simply to keep the locals quiet, to preserve the peace of Rome. I had hoped my assignment in Judea would be a short stay, but the months have turned into years, and I'm ready to go home. Defending Rome from her enemies is one thing, but when they ask me to commit murder, I just can't do it anymore. As an officer, I was allowed to bring my wife, Claudia, and our daughter along on this assignment. That made this tour of duty a bit more bearable, until our little girl, Athena, suddenly became ill. We don't know what caused it, but her sickness progressed so quickly we feared for her life. Claudia had met a woman in the marketplace in Capernaum, who spoke of a prophet, a folk healer, and urged us to seek his help. It seemed this man named Jesus had the powers to heal sickness, and although I hesitated at first, imagine a Roman asking a Jew for help. I would do anything to save my beloved daughter's life. I found him surrounded by hundreds of his followers outside of Decapolis. I forced my way through the crowd and approached him just as he was lifting an older man up from the ground. The scene was difficult to watch, even for a battle-worn soldier. This man must have broken his leg as a child, and his knee was bent away from him at a grotesque angle. This healer, Jesus. He glanced at me briefly as I approached. Then, running his hands down both sides of the joint, he straightened the man's leg as if he was rebuilding it. The man jumped and shouted, praising their Jewish God. A woman standing nearby nearly fainted, and a fear I had never known filled my mind. What kind of man or God could do such things? As if he could read my mind, Jesus looked directly at me and asked, "What do you want me to do for you?" But how could he know? I'm a man of power and strength, but I suddenly felt humbled by this man's quiet authority and replied, "My daughter, she is terribly ill. I know I cannot ask you to enter the home of a Gentile. If you would simply say the word, she will be healed." He turned to those standing nearby and said to them, "I've never met anyone in Israel with this much faith." Then to me, he simply said, "Go home and all will be well." And with that, he turned and walked away. I had a pocket full of money. I had come prepared to bargain or offer him protection, but he asked nothing of me but faith. Honestly, with what I saw in that man on that day, it was hard not to have faith. I and the men with me quickly left to return to Capernaum, but before we arrived, my sergeant met us along the way. When I saw him, I feared for the worst, but the smile on his face gave me hope. "Athena is well," he said. "The fever broke early this morning. She's playing in the front yard and asking for her daddy. I rushed home and gathered her into my arms as if I would never let her go, but my mind was focused on the healer from Galilee. These are the thoughts that fill my mind even now as I stand here. Another killing. Another terrible injustice. I can't bear it anymore. Why the healer? Why must he die? Even the governor admitted that Jesus has done nothing worthy of death, but his own people have conspired to kill him. The whole earth seems to cry out in protest. The earth quakes, and the midday appears as dark as midnight. Yet in the midst of this horror, Jesus is still a man of peace. I hear him crying out to God, asking God to forgive us for what we are doing to him. Again, I am standing face to face with this man, and again, it is hard not to have faith. Surely, this man was the Son of God.
Thank you.
The voice of Jesus is the voice of obedience. We hear him pray, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted me authority over all people, that I might grant eternal life to everyone whom you have given to me. This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me, just as you know me, Father, and I know you. So I sacrifice my life for the sheep. You love me because I sacrifice my life so I may take it back again. No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it freely, for I have the authority to lay it down when I want to and also to take it up again. For this is what you have sent me to do. Everyone that you have given to me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will certainly not cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. For this is your will, that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I myself will raise him up on the last day. For you loved the world so much that you sent me, your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in me shall not perish but have eternal life. For you did not send me into the world to judge the world, but rather that through me the world might be saved. Anyone who believes in me is not judged. But he who does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God."
Strong and perfect, we
This evening, as we have navigated our journey of Christ's passion, that is his suffering and his death, we've encountered many voices along our way. Now, many of these voices are voices that are full of defiance and deception, rebellion and rejection, but some of these voices are full of affirmation and proclamation of the truth. The question we have to ask ourselves is, which voice will we listen to? Because the truth is, we hear these voices every day, and we even speak using these voices every day of our lives. So which voice will we listen to? God's desire is that we listen to the only voice that matters, the voice of Jesus Christ himself, the voice of our good shepherd. Hear now the words of Jesus Christ himself speaking in John chapter 10, verse 27. Where he says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." May we be a people who hear and heed and follow the voice of the one who knows us, the one who loves us, and the one who died for us on that first Good Friday. Thank you for joining us this evening. As we look ahead, I want to invite you to come back and join us again for worship on Easter Sunday. Death would not be the end of Jesus, and I am so thankful for that. You can join us on Easter Sunday by visiting wcchapel.org/worship, and we would love to have you join us for the continuation of the story, where we will hear about Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. Sunday's coming, and I can't wait. God bless, and have a wonderful evening.